Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to a new episode of The Successors. With me, your host, Muhammad Shia'. Before I begin, I would like to send my congratulations to the Islamic Ummah and to the Master of our time, His Majesty Imam Mahdi, may Allah hasten his reappearance. On this very blessed occasion, Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini is joining us tonight to shed some light upon the biography of Imam Muhammad Al-Jawad. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaykum as-salam.
How do you do?
Alhamdulillah Rabbil
Alameen. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. During the time of the ninth Imam, there were many scholars and thinkers that led various schools and schools of thought. And of course, they had opinions on the opposing leaders of the opposing schools. What was said about Imam Al-Jawad by those, you know, those scholars? Words of praise, or what happened at that time?
Sure. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين. I also would like to take this opportunity to congratulate my dear host and our dear viewers on the happy occasion of the birthday of our blessed ninth Imam Al-Imam Al-Jawad عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام. Upon him and his forefathers and his progeny. Before we talk about what figures from the other school of thought of Imam al-Jawad and what they said about him, how about we first see what, you know, what the Ahlul Bayt said about him, and then we slowly move on to see what others.
To the other schools.
Because, you know, there's no praise better than the praise of
the
infallible
Ahlul Bayt.
Imam.
Definitely.
And Ahlul Bayt.
Definitely.
And there's no better praise than his own father, Imam Rida, alayhi
salam,
who was his father and the one who raised him, and he was his predecessor. Imam Jawad was his father's successor. Of course, when we read praise like the one we're about to see, some fathers might be emotional and not so objective towards their children. Obviously, your son, you have a soft spot for your children.
Definitely.
And you'll tend to give a blind eye to their weaknesses and concentrate more on their strength than on, you know.
But in the life of the infallibles, that wouldn't be counted.
Ahlul Bayt would not do that. When they speak the truth. Just like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Quran says regarding Rasulullah, وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ
إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا
وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. When Rasulullah praised Amir al-Mu'mineen, it's because he deserved the praise.
Because it was a divine inspiration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
It was divine inspiration from Allah. Same goes for the praise that Rasulullah said towards Fatima al-Zahra. You know, in our episodes on Fatima al-Zahra, for example, Rasulullah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْضَى لِرَضَى فَاطِمَ وَيَغْضُبْ لَغَضَبَهَا. He's not saying this because she's his daughter, but because it's the truth. It's the genuine truth. Same goes for Imam al-Rida. We see in some narrations that before his birth, Imam Rida had stated, "Wallah la tamdhi al-ayyam wal-layali hatta yarzuqani Allahu waladan dhakaran yufarriqu bihi bayna al-haqq wal-batil." Imam Rida foretold about the birth of his son Imam al-Jawad, and he said, "Allah will give me a son because Imam al-Jawad when Imam al-Jawad was born, of course it was a joyous occasion for Ahlul Bayt, and he was a successor of Imam Rida. Before that, Imam Rida did not have any successor to continue the line of Ahlul Bayt. Some assumed that he might be the final Imam. Some assumed that Imam Rida might be the final Imam because he didn't have any children. And even after the birth of Imam al-Jawad was so young that they didn't believe that he could be the next Imam. So they assume that it's going to stop at Imam Rida, but Imam Rida showed them that the line of Ahlul Bayt is going to continue. And this is word of praise for Imam al-Jawad. Waladan dhakaran, first of all, he will be a boy, not a girl. To yufarriqu bihi bayna al-haqq wal-batil. He will differentiate, he will distinguish between truth
and falsehood.
This is great praise for Imam al-Jawad.
Definitely.
In another narration, the first is in Al-Kafi, another narration in Rijal Al-Kishi, which is a well-known book of Rijal that we, يعني, that
in علم الرجال,
in علم الرجال and in Hawza, they rely on this book, Rijal Kishi. Imam Rida says, حتى يولد, in another narration, it's the same narration but in another version, حتى يولد ذكر من صلبي يقوم مثل مقامي. He will sit in my position, and he will be an imam like me. Meaning, don't underestimate him. If you see him as a child, don't think that he's a normal child.
He has a divine knowledge.
He has divine knowledge, he's been divinely ordained. يحيي الحق ويمحي الباطل. يحيي الحق. He will give life to the truth, and he will destroy باطل. Beautiful. And indeed,
that's a very beautiful praise.
Indeed, when we look at the life of Imam Al-Jawad, with the debates that he had, the dialogues that we had in the first and second episodes with my dear host, Brother Hussein Sufni, we talked about the debates that Imam Al-Jawad had with Yahya ibn Aktham, who was, you know, you could call him the Grand Mufti of the time.
Of the time.
And others. Imam Al-Jawad, at a young age, you know, possessed so much knowledge and so much wisdom. And not just that, but the eloquence to deliver that
knowledge. The eloquence
knowledge
of his speech, subhanAllah.
There are some people that carry a lot of knowledge, but they don't know how to express it. Imam Al-Jawad, at a young age, was able to express that knowledge to show that the truth is with Ahlul Bayt.
Well, he's the grandson of Imam Ali alayhi salam.
Right.
Definitely.
But Imam Al-Jawad became an imam at the age of 8 or 9. Mm-hmm. And this was a problem for people. That how could a child become an imam at that age? Imam Al-Jawad proved that the truth is with Ahlul Bayt. Because if an 8 or 9-year-old can carry so much knowledge and wisdom and divine inspiration, then imagine what would a 70-year-old like Imam Sadiq carry, or a person like Imam Ali, or a person like Imam Rida, who were a lot older than him. If a child has so much from Ahlul Bayt, imagine what
the elder ones
had. In another narration, and this narration is popular regarding Imam Al-Jawad, very beautiful narration. Mm-hmm. When he was born, when Imam Al-Jawad was born, Imam Al-Hadi said a praise, you know, a word of praise that wasn't said about any other imam.
Imam Al-Rida.
Imam Al-Rida. He said about his son. He said, هذا المولود الذي لم يولد مولود أعظم بركة على شيعتنا منه. This child, there's never been in history a child born with more blessings upon our Shia more than Imam Al-Jawad. The birth of Imam Al-Jawad brought more blessings for the Shia than any other imam.
SubhanAllah.
Of course, some might not know what the Imam Rida meant. Was he going to come and pass out money? Was he going to be Al-Mahdi? Who will rule? Is he going to be, you know, a king?
Definitely, there were many interpretations of this hadith.
There are many interpretations. I personally think that Imam Al-Jawad was a sign of the glory of Ahlul Bayt. A sign of their knowledge. You know, when you go to a family, and you visit a family, and they have a 5-year-old child, that's very nice. Full of etiquette. He comes and greets you at the door. Very polite. He comes and sits like an adult. You ask him, you know.
Speaks like an adult.
He speaks like an adult. He answers questions like an adult. And he's the first person that you meet. You say, wow. If their 5-year-old child
is like
is
that,
like this,
what
imagine
the family?
The other, you know, imagine his siblings. His 15 and 20 and 25-year-old siblings. Imagine what they would be like. Imagine his father. Imagine his grandfather. If the baby of the family is like this, imagine the rest. I think Imam Rida was trying to allude to this, that Imam Al-Jawad was the miracle of Ahlul Bayt. That at the age of 8 or 9, and as we said, he was the first imam.
He was the first imam to ascend at the age of 8.
At that age, at a very young age. People were baffled to see a child act like an adult and do everything that an adult does except his ages 8 or 9. This showed that the Ahlul Bayt were real. They were the real deal. And they deserve to be followed. And everyone else was fake.
It shows that the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam were divine inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Divine inspired because Imam Al-Jawad didn't go to any school. He wasn't schooled. He wasn't trained. just like his son, Imam al-Hadi, and we talked about during the days of Imam al-Hadi, about al-Junaydi, who tried to teach Imam al-Hadi while he ended up being the student of Imam al-Hadi. These people didn't go to schools. They were divinely inspired. Another story that is very amazing, it's very beautiful, and it shows that the truth is with the Ahlul Bayt and with Imam al-Jawad. Ali ibn Ja'far, the brother of Musa ibn Ja'far, the son of Imam al-Sadiq. Imam al-Sadiq had several sons. One of them was Ismail, one of them was Abdullah, one of them was Musa, Imam al-Kadhim, and one of them was Ali. Ali was very young when his father, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, died. He was young. Mm-hmm. He was an orphan, because when his father died, he was still a child. So who took care of him and raised him and educated him? His brother, Musa ibn Ja'far.
And that would be the best, you know, care best provided. Definitely.
And this Ali ibn Ja'far was a scholar. He was a very bright student of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far. Until today, we have a book that we depend on in Hawza. We depend on in the process of Ijtihad. One of the famous books of Hadith in small volumes, not the
not the big volumes.
Not the big volumes like Al-Kafi, Al-Tahdhib. No, the small volumes. And by the way, those big volumes are made up of these small volumes. One of them is called Masail Ali ibn Ja'far. Basically, a set of questions, bunch of questions regarding everything from Hajj to Khums to Salah, Zakat, you name it. And Ali ibn Ja'far asked his brother and he would record. He would sit and write down the answers. So this shows that he was a student of his brother, Musa ibn Ja'far. He was raised in his house. And unfortunately, Imam al-Kadhim has not been given enough credit when it comes to fiqh and educating. Usually when we talk about education and the role of the imams that educated, we usually emphasize on Imam al-Baqir and Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. But Imam Musa al-Kadhim also played a major role. And proof of that is the book, Masail Ali ibn Ja'far. Mm-hmm. There's another book called Al-Ja'fariyat, also ascribed to Ali ibn Ja'far. Anyhow, Ali ibn Ja'far was accepted by all. He was pious, he was a scholar, and he was from the Ahlul Bayt. He was the son of an imam, the father of an imam, I'm sorry, the son of an imam, the brother of an imam, the uncle of an imam, and the great uncle of an imam. He was the son of Imam al-Sadiq, the brother of Imam al-Kadhim, the uncle of Imam al-Ridha, the great uncle of Imam al-Jawad. One day, he was seen coming inside the masjid in Medina. And he was inside the masjid. Imam al-Jawad entered. Imam al-Jawad was
a young,
10, 11, not older than that. Maybe 9 years old. He got up, he stood up. He was an old man by this time. This is his brother's grandson. Imam al-Jawad was his great nephew.
Yeah. Or grand. But the great divine inspiration of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would differentiate that.
So he got up and he ran towards Imam al-Jawad and he grabbed his hand to kiss it.
SubhanAllah.
He ran without his shoes, without his abaya. He ran to Imam al-Jawad and he kissed his hand. Imam al-Jawad told him, Ya Am Ijlus, rahimakallah. Sit, please, don't stand up for me. He respected him.
Definitely, as a father's uncle. Yeah.
Great uncle. Ali ibn Ja'far, he said, Ya Sayyidi, kayfa ajlus wa anta qa'im? You're standing. You want me to sit? You want me to sit while you're standing? No. We either sit together or we stand together. Khalas. He asked him to sit wherever he was seated.
And that shows the akhlaq of the Ahlul Bayt, the morals.
This shows the akhlaq of Ali ibn Ja'far himself. This shows the greatness of Imam al-Jawad. He went and he sat back with his friends, and Imam al-Jawad sat in another corner. His friends, apparently they weren't good friends. He told him, Ya Ali, this guy's your brother's grandson. You're his father's uncle. You're an old man. He's a child. What is this that you're doing? You stand in front of everyone, you rush, you run to him, and you kiss his hand. He's a child. And you're an old man. And you're not a regular person. You're from Ahlul Bayt.
You are a pious scholar and you are an accepted
If you claim to be an imam, you could have been an imam. If you tell people I'm an imam, they'll believe
they'll
you.
They'll believe you, definitely.
So what do you want me to do? Allah did not see this shayba, and he pointed to his white beard. Mm-hmm. He did not see this shayba worthy of being an imam. But he saw that child worthy of being an imam. Is that my fault?
SubhanAllah.
This is Allah's will. Allah wanted that child to be an imam and this old man not to be an imam. Don't blame me. He's my imam. I will go and I am honored to go and kiss his hand. He didn't say this, but basically that's the message that he was...
Definitely, that he wanted to deliver.
Beautiful words. Beautiful words. Beautiful words. And this is a very pious man. If it was anyone other than Ali ibn Ja'far, he might have claimed the imam for himself. He's old. Has a white beard, he has the looks of an imam, he's the son of an imam, the brother of an imam, and he's carrying a lot of knowledge with him. It's not someone, you know, who's ignorant, who people would catch him right away.
Definitely.
But he didn't, he was pious. This is my imam. An 8-year-old child is more worthy of being an imam more than anyone else.
This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, yani.
Ahsant. This is from words of praise from the Ahlul Bayt. Let's come to the other school of thought. Al-Allama Sabt ibn al-Jawzi, well-known scholar. He was Hanafi. He was not a follower of Ahlul Bayt. He followed Abu Hanifa. Regarding Imam al-Jawad in Tadhkirat al-Khawas, in his book, he says, وَمُحَمَّدْ الْإِمَامْ أَبُو جَعْفَرَ الثَّانِي كَانَ عَلَىٰ مِنْهَاجِ أَبِيهِ فِي الْعِلْمِ. He calls him Imam. He calls him Abu Ja'far al-Thani. We mentioned in the first episode that he was called Abu Ja'far al-Thani because Imam al-Baqir was Abu Ja'far. Ja'far. To differentiate between him and Imam al-Baqir, he was called Abu Ja'far al-Thani. كان على منهج أبيه في العلم والتقى والزهد والجود. He followed the path of his father when it came to knowledge and piety and simplicity and generosity. وكان يلقب بالمرتضى والقانع. And he was styled المرتضى like his father, like his grandfather Imam Ali. المرتضى is the one who is pleased upon. المرتضى, the one who is accepted, pleased with. والقانع, the one who is satisfied. Another Sunni scholar, الشيخ كمال الدين محمد بن طلحة الشافعي. He says, وَإِنْ كَانَ صَغِيرُ السِّنِ فَهُوَ كَبِيرُ الْقَدْرِ رَفِيعُ الذِّكْرِ. He says, although he was young in age, yet he was big in status.
And those scholars were from different, you know, thoughts.
One was Maliki, one was Hanafi. This shows that
the greatness of the Imam Jawad.
The greatness, and he was accepted by all schools of thought. All schools of thought and all historians accept him as a pious, righteous, spiritual, religious, intellectual scholar of Islam, although they do not witness that he was a divinely ordained imam, but nevertheless they accept him as a great member of Ahlul Bayt.
Sayyidina, we will continue inshallah through a short break
inshallah
discussion. Respected viewers, we will continue our discussion inshallah after a short break, so stay tuned. أتينا لبابك كي نهتدي جواد الأئمة يا سيدي أتينا لبابك كي نهتدي علمنا يقينا بأن الذي يريد الإله بكم يبتدي تحوم الملائك طرا عليه أفودا من الباب للمرقد علمنا يقينا بأن الذي يريد الإله بكم يبتدي تحوم الملائك طرا
علي وفودا من الباب للمرقد وتمسح منك الضريح الشموس فيرقى جمالا على الفرقد وتمسح منك الضريح الشموس فيرقى جمالا على الفرقد وتمسح منك الضريح الشموس فيرقى جمالا على
Respected viewers, back to our discussion about the biography of Imam Muhammad Al-Jawad, peace be upon him. Sayyidina, the bright and most outstanding faces of his nature and character were to show hospitality and politeness to all without any discrimination, to help the needy, to observe equality under all circumstances, to live a simple life, to help the orphans, the poor and the homeless, to teach those interested in the achievement of knowledge, and to judge and to guide the people to the right path. Out of the several attributes that the Imam alayhi salam possessed, why was he called Al-Jawad?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Imam Al-Jawad had all of the qualities that you just mentioned. In the life of Ahlul Bayt, when we look at the lives of Ahlul Bayt, they all have the same qualities.
The same qualities and the same attributes.
But one of them had one quality more, a bit more. It stood out in him more. Like Imam Zain al-Abidin. They all prayed. They all prayed at night.
They were all pious.
They were all pious. But Imam Zain al-Abidin went a step further. And I think that the Imams, they worked as a team on this. They worked as a team. At the end of the day, they're role models for everyone. For example, if they saw that Imam Ali alayhi salam symbolized courage, Imam al-Hasan al-Mujtaba would symbolize generosity, like Imam al-Jawad. Imam al-Hussein saw Imam al-Hasan symbolize generosity, he went towards self-sacrifice. Imam Zain al-Abidin saw that his father went towards self-sacrifice, I will come towards spirituality. Imam al-Baqir saw that, there's a gap in knowledge, I will come towards intellectuality, and so on and so forth. They completed one another. They all have the same qualities, but each one stood out with one specific quality the most.
He was differentiated with this particular quality.
This is one. Two, we believe that these titles, they were given to them by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were not chosen by the people. These were titles chosen by the Ahlul Bayt themselves. When we call Imam Muhammad ibn Ali Al-Baqir, he was named Al-Baqir. Rasulullah named him Al-Baqir. Rasulullah named Ja'far ibn Muhammad Al-Sadiq. Rasulullah named Musa ibn Ja'far Al-Kadhim. These weren't titles, elected by the people or chosen by the people. No, they were mentioned by Rasulullah and it continued on the tongues of Ahlul Bayt. They were called by their specific names and by their specific attributes. When we look at the life of Imam al-Jawad, indeed, he was someone known for his generosity. His generosity stood out.
Stood out the most among all.
Stood out the most. It's like, when you see beautiful people, a couple of brothers, they might be all good-looking, attractive, but one of them stands out the most. It doesn't mean that the others are not beautiful, but this person, his beauty stands out the most. Same goes for Imam al-Jawad. His generosity stands out the most. In one narration, Ahmed ibn Hadid, a well-known figure at the time of Imam al-Jawad, he came with a group of his followers to Mecca for Hajj. On the way, they were stopped by a gang and they were robbed of all of the money that they had. Mm-hmm. When they arrived to Medina. On their way to Mecca, they stopped in Medina. Imam al-Jawad heard about the story. Perhaps either Ahmed ibn Hadid told Imam al-Jawad the story, or he heard. Imam al-Jawad prepared food, clothing, and money
to aid those people.
To aid Ahmed ibn Hadid and his friends. When Ahmed ibn Hadid opened the sum, opened the bag of money, he saw that it's the exact amount
that he lost.
Subhanallah. Imam Jawad alayhi salam provided him exactly with what he lost. Ahmed ibn Habib, you know, he didn't require him to be his follower. Imam Jawad did not require Ahmed ibn Hadid to be his follower, to be among the Shia, or to come and testify.
That event would, you know, would bring Ahmed ibn Hadid to the Ahlul Bayt, to the path of the Ahlul Bayt. Right.
Today, we live at a time, you want a group or a country or a government or a political party or to support you,
you've got to follow them.
You have to follow them. You want this government to follow you, to support you, that means you're going to have to follow that government.
To accept their set of policies.
Conditions, exactly. If we today were to ask any government for support or a loan, they might give us, but it's not conditional.
Free.
It's not for free, it's conditional. Tomorrow that government, that country might wage war. They'll expect us to support them. Either through money or through manpower or by, you know,
by the military
army,
force,
military force. Nothing's for free. Not just governments, even political parties, even certain individuals. Nothing is for free. They give you money,
they expect something in return.
Except the Ahlul Bayt. The Ahlul Bayt never expected anything for return. And that is why they stand out more than anyone else. In another incident, Imam Al-Jawad, and they testify, the story testifies to the Imam's generosity, not just for humans, but even for animals. Imam Al-Jawad was sitting outside, you know, kind of like a picnic. And he had people with him, his servants. They were also with him at the picnic. You know, when you're eating outside, food tends to fall on the ground. A loaf of bread, some meat, whatever it is, it fell. And, you know, you could easily wash it and eat it later on or reheat it or whatever. Mm-hmm. Imam Jawad, when his servants were, you know, repacking the food, there was stuff on the ground, food on the ground. He said, leave this, khalas. What's on the ground is on the ground for the vultures and for the birds and for the animals to
eat. That will come later and eat it.
That will come later on and eat it. He says, مَا كَانَ فِي الصَّحْرَاءِ فَدَعْهُ وَلَوْ فَخِذِ شَاتٍ. Even if it was, what do you call it?
A lamb's leg.
Which is full of meat, right? The
Definitely.
Best part of a lamb
is
the legs, because they're full of meat. He said, even if that falls on the ground, you leave it on the ground. That's for the animals to eat. Subhanallah. Someone who is generous and who thinks of even the animals, not just humans, right? You have generosity. Generosity is on...
You have the human generosity and
human
you
generosity.
Have the divine generosity.
Generosity.
SubhanAllah.
No, sometimes you're generous with... humans, other times you're generous even with animals. That's a generosity on another level. You know, generosity is a virtue above many other virtues. It's a very beautiful virtue that Allah loves. In a hadith, basically the meaning of the hadith is that al-kareem qareebun min al-nas, qareebun min al-qalb, qareebun min Allah, قَرِيبٌ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ بَعِيدٌ عَنِ النَّارِ.
SubhanAllah.
A generous person is close to people's hearts, he's close to the people, he's close to Allah, he's close to paradise, and he's far from hellfire. البخيل, someone who's stingy and greedy, is the complete opposite. بَعِيدٌ عَنِ النَّاسِ. بَعِيدٌ عَنِ اللَّهِ. بَعِيدٌ عَنِ الْجَنَّةِ قَرِيبٌ مِنَ النَّارِ. A person who's stingy is far from people, far from people's hearts. People don't like those that are greedy,
person.
A stingy person. He's far from people. He's far from paradise. He's far from Allah.
And close
and
to hellfire.
Close to hellfire.
SubhanAllah.
You know, when you see someone who's generous, immediately you're attracted to him. Even if he's not a believer. even if he's not a believer.
We have many narrations that many of the Ahlul Kitab, Jews and Christians, who were generous, but the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam predicted that these people would go to Jannah, subhanAllah.
Right, yeah. Right. Fir'aun. Fir'aun, the Pharaoh that was at the time of Musa, because there were many Pharaohs. Mm-hmm. The Pharaoh at the time of Musa would slaughter a big number of sheep, camels, cows every day and feed people. Just do it out of generosity. Of course, he didn't do it for the sake of Allah because he didn't believe in Allah. He claimed to be God himself. He did it for the sake of feeding, for the sake of generosity. People came and told him that this is going to harm the economy. Reduce that amount. He said, I'm not going to reduce it all at once because I've got people used to eating at that time. So he said, we'll do it in stages. If we slaughter, for example, 1,000, let's do it, 950, and then 900, and then 850, and so on and so forth until we stop the habit. And indeed, that's what happened. It reduced until he stopped feeding. The day that he stopped feeding, he drowned that day.
SubhanAllah.
He drowned on the day that he stopped feeding people.
SubhanAllah.
This shows that Allah was, as long as he was generous to the people, Allah was delaying his wrath. Allah was delaying the punishment. But as soon as he stopped, the generosity stopped, the punishment came. So sometimes generosity pushes the punishment away.
SubhanAllah. Is there any events that, that was particulated to the generosity of Imam Al-Jawad, with people, or particularly, orphans and whatsoever?
Yes, they mention about him that he wouldn't say no to anyone. He wouldn't say no to anyone. Whoever asked him.
So whoever asked him for help.
Whoever asked him for help, friend or foe, relative or non-relative, from Medina or not from, a Shi'i or a non-Shi'i, whoever asked him for support, he would not say no. He would give, and he would give generously.
SubhanAllah.
He would give generously. Imam Al-Jawad, first of all, he had khums and zakat delivered to him from various countries. Shia, by the time of Imam Al-Jawad, had spread everywhere. They were in Iran, they were in Khurasan, they were in Qom, they were in Hijaz, they were in Iraq, in Kufa, in Basra. Mm-hmm. These countries, they were rich, especially Iraq. Ardu Sawadain. Iraq was known for its plantations, its farms, its gardens. All of these farms, they produced a lot of wealth. The Shia would bring their khums to Imam Al-Jawad. So that was one of his revenue. Another was from Al-Ma'mun. Al-Ma'mun, at some point of time, especially since he gave his daughter to Imam Al-Jawad, Imam Al-Jawad was married to the daughter of Al-Ma'mun.
SubhanAllah.
Umm al-Fadl, he would give him money. He had a certain budget for Imam Al-Jawad. He had guards. He had servants appointed by Al-Ma'mun. He had all of that. But historians say he didn't use any of it for himself. All of the wealth that he had was for the people.
It was for the people.
It was for anyone who needed help, whether it was Shia or not Shia. And this shows his generosity. And none of it was used for him, for himself. And this is a sign of a generous person. Mm-hmm. A generous person is not the one who spends the most. No. A generous person is the one who spends that which he needs. If this sibha, this subha might not have a lot of value. But if it's the only thing that I own, but I give it to someone else, this is generosity.
This would be considered, yeah.
This is considered generosity. It's not just about the amount that you spend. If you're a billionaire and you spend in millions,
that wouldn't be generosity.
Because you don't need it.
Mm-hmm. But if you give the things that you need, it would be generosity.
That person is generous.
SubhanAllah. The qualities and personalities and characteristics of Imam Muhammad Al-Jawad. So, yeah, an elaboration on the qualities, personalities and characteristics of Imam Muhammad Al-Jawad.
Sure. First of all, Imam Al-Jawad was special from the early days.
SubhanAllah.
Hakima, the daughter of Imam Al-Kadhim and the sister of Imam Al-Rada and the aunt of Imam Al-Jawad. She says that she tells Imam Al-Rada. She told him that when your son Imam Al-Jawad was born, apparently Imam Al-Rada was in Khurasan when Imam Jawad was born. Imam Jawad was born in Medina, and Imam Rida was born, was living in Khurasan, according to some narrations. Or others might say that no, he was born in, when he was born, Imam Rida was also in Medina. But according to the historical facts, everyone knows that Imam Jawad was born in Medina, and most likely at the time, Imam Rida was already in Khurasan. Why? I will mention that later on. Hakima tells him that when your son Imam Al-Jawad was born, the first words that he said was "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah."
Subhanallah, interesting.
Right. In another narration, she says, Hakima, she says that when he was born, he sneezed. And when he sneezed, he said, Alhamdulillah, wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi al-akhyar al-tayyibin.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So it was a miracle.
A miracle. Right in the beginning. As soon as he was born. He was asked, how could you be an imam at such a young age? That was one of his merits. Definitely. One of his qualities was that he attained knowledge at a young age. He said, I'm not exceptional. Look at Sulaiman and Dawood. Sulaiman was a child, but Dawood was asked to give the Khilafah to Sulaiman while Sulaiman was a child. That was knowledge in itself. As a child, to say that I'm not an exception, Dawood gave
to have the knowledge from Dawood and from Prophet Dawood.
Ahsant. And he reads from the Quran. He tells them. The Quran says regarding Yahya, وَآتَيْنَاهُ الْحُكْمَ صَبِيَّ. Right? He supports how he received wisdom at such a young age. In another instance, he says regarding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Imam Ali. He says, the Quran says regarding Rasulullah, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنَ اتَّبَعَنِي. Say to them, Ya Rasulullah, that this is my path. I am calling people to Allah. And I am know what I'm doing. I have basira, meaning I have vision of what I am doing, me and whoever follows me. Scholars say that أَنَا وَمَنَ اتَّبَعَنِي was Imam Ali. Imam Jawad says, the verse is speaking about Rasulullah and Imam Ali. And at that age, at that time, Imam Ali was 9 years old. I'm like my grandfather, Imam Ali alayhi salam. If Allah reveals an entire verse about Imam Ali, who followed Rasulullah and praises him at the age of 9, well, I'm 9 years old right now. This is wisdom, to think like this.
It's a divine wisdom, definitely.
To justify how he could be an imam at such an age. Imam Jawad had knowledge.
But it's also difficult to convince the people of Arabia at that time.
Right. He had knowledge. He had knowledge of the Quran. He had knowledge of verses. He was asked about the verse, ما ننسخ من آية أو ننسها نأتي بخير منها. He explained to them what نسخ means, abrogation. ننسها, we make the verse forgotten. How do we make the verse forgotten? We bring a verse better than that verse. What's the explanation of all these verses? Because if we take the apparent meaning, it might be a bit problematic. The Imam explained. أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يَأْتِ بِكُمُ اللَّهُ جَمِيعًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلُّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. He was asked about this verse at the age of 8 or 9. And the Imam explains the meaning of this verse.
Of those verses.
Among his qualities were his prayers.
SubhanAllah.
Like his forefathers, Imam Jawad was known for his nawafil, the recommended prayers. Not just the wajib prayers, but the recommended prayers. And, you know, for us, regular people, when we want to perform a recommended prayers, it will be two units, raka'atayn, and we do it very quickly. Imam Al-Jawad, he stands and he recites, according to narrations, in each raka'ah, he would recite, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, Surah قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, 70 times.
SubhanAllah. 70 times. That was times. Particular ability that he
had. Right. That, you know, that would take at least 30 minutes. If he wants to do it with khushu', he wants to recite it slowly, that would take at least 30 minutes. His prayers were exceptional. His hajj was exceptional. Narrators say that his hajj was unbelievable. The way that he would enter Masjid al-Haram, the way he would perform tawaf. With every circle, he would come to al-Rukn al-Yamani and embrace it. He would kiss it. When he would finish, he would come in and embrace Hajar al-Aswad.
Definitely, he's from the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. So all the qualities and personalities, characteristics of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam passes from one to one because of the divine knowledge they have, because of the divine care that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for them.
Right.
Sayyidina, we will conclude our episode inshaAllah. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, we reach the end of our show for now. Thank you very much indeed for watching. Don't forget the dua to hasten the reappearance of the master of our time, His Majesty Imam al-Mahdi. May Allah hasten his reappearance. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.